Hi, this is Graham. Hope everyone's having a great day. This video will be of interest to those people who have bought a new FZ200 camera and are having problems setting up the camera to take decent photographs. Some people prefer to use a manual to find the way around the camera. Other people prefer a show and tell video, and that's the reason I'm carrying out this video today. Once you buy your FZ200, the first process is to charge the battery before you install it into the camera. So you place that in your respective charger and charge up the battery until the indicator light goes out. To install the battery needs to be oriented so that the metal contacts face in towards the camera and the Lumix logo is facing you. And then that just fits into the battery compartment and latches in place. The next thing to install is your memory card. And the choice of memory card will depend on whether you're shooting just video or you want to shoot video and stills at the same time. The cards are designated by size in terms of memory capacity and also in speed rating. If you're only interested in shooting stills, then you can get away with using a Class 2 card, and they're much cheaper than the more expensive Class 6 or Class 10 cards, which are recommended for video. The size of card will depend again on how many photographs you want to store on the card or how much video you want to shoot. If you bought the camera in a brick and mortar store, probably the camera salesperson tempted you to buy a 32GB card at Class 10. These are ideal if you're going to be shooting extended periods of video at the highest AVC HD codec. If you're just going to be using MP4 because your computer won't edit AVC HD, you need to be using a Class 10 card, but I wouldn't recommend you buy 32GB cards, just use 16GB cards. To install the memory card, again, it's in the battery compartment. You want the metal contacts facing towards the camera and the logo of the sdhc card facing the front of the camera. And again, it just fits into the slot and latches in position. Then you can lock the camera door. The next challenge then is to install the lens hood. And I've had several queries regarding the correct fitting of this lens hood, and in fact I produced a video to show you how to do that, as some people were having difficulty fitting this lens hood, and in fact a couple of people have actually lost theirs because the lens hood wasn't fitted correctly. The lens hood fits to a bayonet track on the outside edge of the lens, and on the lens hood itself there's a little index mark. To install the lens hood with the camera power off so that the lens is still fully retracted, you put the index mark at about 10-2 on the clock face. Then rotate the lens hood to the 12 o'clock position where you'll feel some resistance. Then just fully rotate the lens hood clockwise until you hear that click. That click is the position that the lens hood is locked in, and that's the stage that some people weren't going to because they feared that they would destroy the lens by applying that amount of pressure. But you need to get it to lock into that 12 o'clock position. When you first get the lens hood, it is quite stiff, but after a couple of times it does slacken off a little. And again, to release it, push press and turn anti-clockwise to release the hood, and then you can actually install it on the camera in the reverse direction, so you can install it in your camera bag as a much smaller object. The next question is regarding the use of filters with this camera, and particularly the use of a UV filter. Again, if you bought the camera in a brick and mortar store, probably the camera salesman advised you to buy a UV filter and probably tempted you to buy one of the more expensive ones as well. My own take on that is that you only need the UV filter if you're going to be using this camera in a dusty environment or one where there's a possibility of salt spray landing on the lens. The reason for that is that once you install a new filter onto the front of this camera, you introduce another air-to-glass-to-air surface. And every time you do that, you get the opportunity for reflections and ghosting to appear from that filter. Particularly if you're shooting towards the light or the light's obliquely entering the lens, you'll notice that you'll get reflection from the surface of the main lens being reflected in this glass coating and back into the camera. You get reduced contrast, you'll see ghost and flares, and if you're at a wide angle setting, if there is any dust on this element, the camera will likely focus on that as well. So again, only use this UV filter if you're going to be using the camera in a dusty environment. If you're worried about protection to the lens, then the lens hood offers physical protection as well as the shade from light, which again can give you reduced contrast. The filters I do recommend are actually the neutral density ND8, which is ideal if you're working in a very bright environment and want to use the wide open f2.8 aperture. If you're in bright sunshine, even with ISO 100, the camera will try to use a shutter speed beyond a 4,000th of a second and will give you an indication that it can't take that photograph. So with the installation of an ND8 filter on the front of the camera, you get a reduction of light of 3 stops, so it gives you the opportunity of using the f2.8 aperture with something like about a 2,000th of a second. The other filter I do recommend is the circular polarizing filter, especially if you're shooting landscapes or you want to reduce reflections from water or from foliage. Again, just screws onto the camera, and then as you look into the viewfinder or the LCD, you can rotate the filter until you find that you're cutting those reflections. Remember, the circular polarizing filter only works on light that's at 90 degree access to the camera. If you're trying to reduce reflections where the light is in line with the camera, you find you can't reduce those as good as with light that's at 90 degrees. And that's the nature of the circular polarizing filter. It does give you accentuated blue skies if you want to bring out the sky and cloud textures. The next thing to set up is the actual camera itself to take photographs. If you're going to be using the camera for the first time digital camera user, you're probably going to be selecting the intelligent auto mode, which is the red IA symbol on the top control dial. If you turn the camera to that position and then turn the camera on, you need to then set up the size and quality of the image that you're going to be taking. By size, I mean the number of megapixels that the image will be made from, and the aspect ratio, the ratio of the width to the height of the photograph. If you are going to be taking stills photograph, your choices are going to be 4:3 aspect ratio, which gives you the equivalent, say, for 8:6 framing, or 3:2, which gives you 6:4. The size will depend on the type of frame and print that you want to make. If you're going to be shooting stills, which will be included in HD video, then you need to select the new 16:9 format, which is there for the HD video. You want to be selecting the highest resolution. So for example, if we go into the menu and cursor down to the camera icon and cursor to the right, you'll notice that the picture size can be set to 12 megapixel at 4:3, 10.5 megapixel at 3:2, or 9 megapixel at 16:9. And I recommend you use the highest resolution to give you the best possible image. Then you can actually crop into that image if you want to reduce the size of the image. So select the aspect ratio that you need for your print or for your HD video, and then press menu set. Below the picture size, you've got the color mode, and by default it's in standard, and I suggest you leave it in there unless you want to go for a higher vibrant picture, which the Panasonic call happy in the intelligent auto mode. The next option in the menu is called Motion Deblur, and Motion Deblur is there to assist the camera in trying to reduce any subject movement. You're probably aware that the camera has optical image stabilization, and that reduces the amount of handshake that's applied to the camera, but it doesn't actually remove any subject movement. So with the Motion Deblur set to on, if you're photographing, for example, children running around or a sports scene, the camera can try and identify the rate of speed change that the subject is making, and then it will adjust the ISO and shutter speed to give you a static subject. The only downside to leaving Motion Deblur off is the fact that you get extended digital zoom. You'll notice that when you use the zoom lever and you zoom out, the camera will move out to the times 24 position and then it pauses. If you continue to zoom, it will then move up to the times 48 position quite quickly, and this is using digital zoom. It's using 2x digital zoom on the times 24 optical zoom. For some subjects it might be okay, but mostly that digital zoom gives you a pixelated image. It loses some of the quality. So unless you desperately need to use digital zoom to get the image that you want to take, I would suggest you don't go beyond the times 24 optical limit. If you do turn Motion Deblur on, then the camera won't use digital zoom and the optical zoom will stop at times 24. The camera will autofocus if you've got the side switch set to the autofocus position or the autofocus macro one, which is the middle position. The difference between the two settings is that in the autofocus macro mode, the camera can focus from 1 meter to infinity. And with the autofocus in the upper position, it will just focus from 2 meters to infinity. The autofocus macro mode allows you to get closer, but if you leave it in that position for general photography, when you take the picture, the camera will focus all the way from its normal setting through to 1 meter back to infinity. So it's much slower to acquire focus. So if you're just taking general pictures, you're not using it for close-ups, set the focus to AF, and that's the upper position, and the camera will focus much quicker and you won't lose the shots as often as if you're using the AF macro mode. You can't use manual mode in the intelligent auto mode, so we'll cover that in a later video. So there we are, that's how to install the battery, to select and install your memory card, and then set up the basic requirements for picture taking for either 4:3, 3:2 or 16:9, dependent on the type of photographs you want to take, and then selecting the color mode and the use of the motion deblur. So until my next video, thanks very much for watching. Please check out my photographic blog, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. And also have a look at the rest of the FZ200 tutorials, and you'll see what this camera is really capable of producing. So until then, thanks again for watching, take care, and bye for now.